All right, well, just picking off from where we left off last week, any questions before I begin talking about the pretty much the rest of chapter 2? I should mention that next week, I guess the quiz is not this Wednesday, right, but the next Wednesday? Okay, so next week what I'll probably do is spend half the time on chapter 3, you know, continuing, and the other half, well, however much you want, really, I guess going over problems from the for the pre-quiz stuff. So there's a lot of samples on the Blackboard site, and there's a lot of solutions, but you might have some questions about it as well. So I'll send out an email about this and try to work out what you all want to do. But yeah, I mean, before I begin, is anything on anyone's mind? All right, well. So the really fundamental fact that I had sort of covered at the very end of last time is that if you have a linear transformation, just to remind you, linear transformation T, which is a function from Rm to Rn, which is very special. It's got to be a very special function. It has the properties that if you have any two vectors, say x and y, and you take t of x plus y, the vector sum, that is equal to t of x plus t of y. So that's really half of the linear property. And the other half is that t of kx, where k is a scalar, so it's just a real number, multiplying all the coordinates of the vector, stretching out the vector, if you will, by a factor of k, the k comes out. And this has to be true for all x and y and for all numbers k. So that is a very restrictive set of conditions. There's not many transformations or functions from Rm to Rn that have these properties. And in fact, as we saw last time, the only ones are functions that arise. So the T gives rise to, there's some matrix A where T of X, so this is the function T of X is equal to A times X, where this is matrix times vector. And here A is N by N, N by M, meaning N by M, and X, well, X, of course, is in Rm, which means that it looks like a vector, well, 1 by M matrix, if you like, or just an M column vector. And we saw how to multiply such a matrix by such a vector to get an n-dimensional vector. So T is a transformation from Rm to Rn. Actually, this is not consistent with how the book does it, is it?
Book does Mn.
Yeah. Actually, does the book do Nm? Mn. Oh, I hate being consistent with the book. Yeah, I think that's right. I think that's right.
Yeah,
it's N by M. Huh? N by M. N by M, right. So the T goes from Rm to Rn. Great. Okay, so we saw this last time, and we even saw how to find the thing. What you do in order to find the matrix is all you have to do is test what happens when you apply T to the special basis vectors. You let E1 be the vector 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, E2 be the vector 0, 1, 0, and so on, all the rest zeros, and so on until you get EM, which is 0. So you just try these vectors, which actually correspond to unit 1 along the coordinate axes. So this is along the x-axis, the y-axis, there's too many dimensions to give them names, but if you're only in two dimensions or three dimensions, this would be x and y, and E3 would be the z-axis. So actually all you have to do is test that out, and then the matrix that you get, that you want to form, is T of E1, which is an n-dimensional vector, because E1 is an m-dimensional vector. So T of E1 will have n entries, so you plug that in there. You calculate T of E2 and plug that column in there, and so on until T of EM and there will clearly be M across and N down. And that matrix is exactly the matrix for the transformation T. So every linear transformation gives rise to a matrix. Every matrix is a linear transformation where the operation is multiplication. Okay, a question.
Yeah, what the transformation of E1, what does that do? How can you transform a standard basis vector since it has zeros and everything is one?
Well, I mean, T is a function from any vector in Rm. So the question is, how can you transform E1? What does that even mean? Well, T is a function from Rm to Rn. So it says if you take any point, 1, 0, 0. I mean, think of this as 1, 0, 0. You plug it into the rule of T and see what you get.
Okay.
And you'll get some other vector, except it will have n coordinates.
Okay.
So, I mean, as a simple example, if T goes from R2 to R3, and I define T of x, y to equal 2x, 3y minus x, y, then you can easily compute T of 1, 0. You just plug in 1, 0. Or if you prefer, T of 1, 0 is the same as T. I don't know. There's just, when I think of the column vector 1, 0, 0, if you want to convert it into a sort of row vector with commas in it, so it's not really a vector but a coordinate type of thing here. This is the same as this. You plug in x equals 1. And y equals 0, whoops, and you get, and there goes the microphone, and I better do a little check again. Are we still on? Cool. Plug in 1, 0, and you get 2, minus 1, 0. And if you plug in 0, 1, you get, 0, 3, 1. So the matrix that we're looking for has these vectors as columns. So the matrix of T in this case is 2, minus 1, 0, 0, 3, 1. And you can check that this is true by multiplying. If you mentally multiply by 1, 0, you get the first column, 2, minus 1, 0. And if you multiply by 0, 1, you get the right column. The nice thing is, if you play this with any other vector, you get T of that vector. So if you want to see what T does to the point 3, minus 2, you plug that in, do the multiplication, and you get the correct result. And that, so T is determined by it's just these two values. That's all you need to know. And the linearity takes care of the rest. It you're very bound up. You have very little choice in the matter. 2 points determines the whole transformation if you're going from R2 to something. If you're going from R5 to something, then you'll need 5 points. So you might as well use these five, E1, E2, E3, E4, E5 in that case. All right, so that's sort of just a little reprise of what I did last time. One of the things I want to do now, I'm going to move on to 2.2, and I kind of want to cover this fairly quickly, although it's pretty important. I've seen a lot of questions about these two-dimensional transformations. So I'm going to look at some special linear transformations. From R2 to R2. And a couple go from R3 to R3. I want to spend a little bit of time on that. Okay, so R2 to R2 is sort of the first interesting case of linear transformations. If you're going from R1 to R1, say, the only linear transformations look something like y equals ax. Y equals ax are the linear transformations. You might think ax plus b, but actually the b kind of screws up these conditions. So it's just y equals ax, just stretching. Nothing interesting there. So somehow the first interesting case are these 2x2 cases. And so any linear transformation from R2 to R2 will have a 2x2 matrix, A, B, C, D. So if it's from R3 to R3, of course it has a 3x3 matrix. So we're going to try to classify some special ones. Now, a very simple one is just a pure old scaling, which is K k, 0, 0. So again, when I say a transformation is a matrix, what I mean is we're going to act on a vector by multiplying. So if we're going to see,
this matrix, we want to see what happens to a vector, we have to take the matrix times a vector.
And of course, this just multiplies both the coordinates by k. If you do this multiplication, kx plus 0y is just kx, and 0x plus ky goes here. So that's just a scaling, and it's just a stretch in all directions by k. So it's not particularly interesting. You can, when I say stretch, I mean if k is bigger than 1, it is actually a stretch, and it's called a dilation. If k is bigger than 1, and it's called a contraction. If k is between 0 and 1. If k equals 1, it's just the identity, it does nothing. If k is negative, it actually flips the directions around. But it's not a very interesting transformation. It's just, it's good to know. In fact, this matrix here is equal to k times the identity matrix. Remember, when you take a outside a matrix, it's got to be multiplied by all the coordinates. So this is k times I2. Remember, this is the 2x2 identity matrix with ones in the diagonal. Okay, so I mean, there's a bunch of terminology there. This scaling isn't particularly interesting. I2
stands for...
I2 means the 2x2 identity. In general, IN is the N by N identity matrix, which looks like 1, 1, 1, 1. All ones on the diagonals and zeros everywhere else, which I can indicate. I really should fill in all the zeros, but I just put a big old zero there to indicate. Now, the reason it's called the identity matrix, by the way, is if this is obviously n-dimensional, but if you take any n-dimensional vector, multiply this by it, you get the same vector back again. So IN times X is equal to X for any n-dimensional vector x, i.e. x in Rn. In times x is x. It's very easy to see. You just multiply it. 1 times the first coordinate goes in the first. This 1 times picks out the second coordinate, and so on until this one picks out the nth coordinate. All right. So in the two-dimensional case, the identity is just this 1, 0, 0, 1. All right. Now, the next two are quite important, and I'm going to show it to you in 2D and 3D. So, whereas the last two only work in 2D as far as we're concerned. Or we'll only look at the 2D versions. Okay, but consider this. This is really important, projection. Now, we looked at this in Math 201 because we actually needed it a little bit. But just to remind you what's going on, you have some line in the plane. And that line is described by a vector, v. Now, v could be, remember, the direction of v matters. The position of v doesn't really matter. But I'm going to consider the vector as described by v here. And I just want to emphasize, v could easily be here, 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 anything pointing along the same way in either direction, and you'll describe the same line. So whatever formula we have for this projection, it shouldn't matter. But the idea is I'm going to take another vector u. Well, actually, let's call it x to be consistent. Another vector x, and I want to project it onto v. I want to project it onto the line described by v. So I want some multiple of v. That somehow is at the base of this perpendicular here. So this is the projection of x onto v. Now the thing to understand is that the projection is a multiple of v. And you see it doesn't change. It's still the same vector. If v was here, it would be a different multiple in terms of the number you have to multiply the vector by. You still end up with the same answer. So as we saw, it turns out that the projection, and here's a formula you really should know, the projection of x onto a vector V, or really the line spanned by V, is x dot V over V dot V times V. X dot V over V dot V times V. The way I write this, it may not be completely obvious, but remember, given two vectors, their dot product is a scalar, meaning a number. So this is just a number divided by a number. So I want you to think of this as i.e. some k times v, where this is a special k, depending on the x. So k of x times v. But this is a scalar times v. So you always end up with something that is a multiple of v, no matter what you start with. Okay? So in order to compute the matrix there, you have to know what V is. Bless you. All right, so I don't know. Let's do an example. So suppose V is the vector 2, 1. Find, OK, so it turns out that the, so I claim that the map that sends T, that sends X to the projection of X on V is linear. This is a linear transformation. Believe it or not, it's linear. And the reason is that the formula X dot V, where V is exactly 2, 1, over 2, 1 dot 2, 1 times 2, 1, that's the formula for it. I claim that that's linear. Well, it's linear because the dot product is linear. If I take this as x plus y, then I can use a distributive law, and I can explode the whole thing into t of x plus t of y. But in any case, it's quite easy to see what's going on. Then if you do t of, say, 1, 0, that's 1, 0, dot 2, 1. We might as well compute this. 2 times 2 is 4, 1, so this is 4 plus 1. And 1, 0, dot 2, 1 is just 2. So this is 2 fifths times 2, 1, otherwise known as 4 fifths, 2 fifths. So if we start building up our matrix, we know the matrix of T looks like T of 1, 0, T of 0, 1. We've just computed T of 1, 0 is 4 fifths, 2 fifths. So we just got to turn it into a column vector as we did. And now we're going to have to finish it off by computing T of 0, 1. Well, that's 0, 1, dot 2, 1 over, well, we already computed the 5 on the bottom. 2, 1, and 0, 1, dot 2, 1. So this is just 1 fifth, which is 2 fifths, 1 fifth. And so that's going to go over here. So that's the matrix of the projection. Okay? It's pretty hard to do that without knowing the formula. Okay, but if you do know the formula, then just make sure you don't get the x and the v switched around here. The function is of x. V is going to be a fixed vector that appears 4 times in this formula. Now, if you know V is a unit vector, of course, you don't need the denominator, because then V dot V is 1. But not always do you have a unit vector, so you better learn it like this. All right, so one thing about the matrix, it turns out that every two-dimensional projection has to look like this. That's assuming, so this is actually the projection for the unit vector u1, u2. So, I mean, you could learn that formula, and then a quick route to this matrix using this formula, if you want, would be to take this vector v as 2, 1, and turn it into a unit vector. U, then, the unit vector is, the norm is 5, norm squared is 5, so the norm is root 5. So you use u equals 2 over root 5, comma 1 over root 5. That is a unit vector that's in the same direction as v. And if you plug that in, 2 over root 5, comma 1 over root 5, you indeed get 4/5, 2/5, 2/5, 1/5. Okay, so I'm not proving this, but I'm just saying if you do this formula in general, as opposed to this specific case, you'll find that you get this. So in particular, this matrix is symmetric. It's symmetric because this is a mirror of this. It's the same entry here. And it has positive entries, or at least non-negative entries, on the diagonal. And any such matrix can be written in this form. So this matrix is called projection. Question. Yeah.
This is a projection for uniformula. Non-uniformula, can we just do this for the uniformula and then multiply?
Well, I did it exactly here. If you, yeah. What I'm saying is, if so v is not a unit vector, right?
Right.
2, 1. But a unit vector in exactly the same direction I can get by dividing by the length of v.
Right.
And then you apply the formula. And if you did apply it to this and this, you will get back this matrix. So I'm offering you two ways to compute a two-dimensional projection. One is to use the basic formula with a specific example and plug it in, and you don't need a unit vector. Or two is to convert it to a unit vector and remember this formula. I kind of prefer this one because this is the first method, because this is a somewhat esoteric formula. I don't remember this formula. I do remember this one. So
this is a projection. This yeah. is just a
No, this is a projection as well. This is okay, let me just explain. This is a projection matrix expressed in terms of a unit vector, and you can always convert any vector into a unit vector by dividing it. So this is a general two-dimensional formula for a projection matrix. However, this formula applies in any dimension.
This is the actual...
That's the definition of projection.
This is the vector. This is just the way to get to the vector, because you need to multiply this with the vector, don't you?
Okay, I'm thinking of this as a function of x. Okay, given an input x, you get a vector out. Okay? If you multiply this by x1, x2,
okay, now they're the same.
Then they're both functions, exactly. Okay. Right, I mean, you're drawing an important distinction here between the matrix and the function. But what happens is you tend to say that a matrix is a function because it's understood, or in fact a linear transformation, because it's understood that whenever you have a matrix, you want to multiply by it. So I will be saying this matrix and this transformation interchangeably, but they're really the same thing. Anyway, the reason I like this formula is because it works in any number of dimensions, including 3, which I'll talk about soon. But first, the question.
So in the example that you just did,
yes.
The vector that we're trying to project is just 1, 1.
The vector we're projecting on into is 2, 1.
Isn't that kind of the line?
Okay. So what... It's a good question. What have we actually done here? What is this matrix here? I will describe exactly what that matrix does. Here's the plane. The point, the vector 2, 1 attached to the origin goes like this. Okay? But we really don't care about that vector so much as the line. So that vector describes, well, this line. Okay? So forget about the vector. Just think about the line. Okay, now, suppose I take any vector at all, and I want to see what happens when I cast the shadow. Vector, call this vector x, which you can think of as x1, x2. And I multiply the vector by this matrix, so I compute now 4/5, 2/5, 2/5, 1/5 times x. Okay, I will get something like this, 4/5 x1 plus 2/5 x2, and so on, and then the other coordinate. Okay, that's the coordinate of this. So this is a general formula for the projection of any vector by multiplication. Now, by the way, suppose you took the vector 2, 1 and applied this. What do you think you should get? Without even doing it in your head, what should it be? If you took 2, 1 and applied it, you should get what?
2, 0.
No, you should get 2, 1. You should get the same. Okay, what I'm saying is, if any multiple, if you have any vector along this line and you project it onto this line, of course you should get the same vector because it is already on the line. Okay, now what happens if you take a vector and do it twice? So I project and then project again. No, you should just, you should, it's the same as if you do it once, right? So in other words, if I do this transformation T, I'm claiming that T of X is equal to T of X. It doesn't matter if you do it twice, because the first time you do it, you project onto the line and you get a vector along that line. And the second time you do it, if you now repeat the projection starting at this vector, you're already on the line, so you get the same vector back. You get the same vector back. So this is kind of nice. This is sort of a nice thing. So, okay. Any other questions about projections? Yes.
So the projection of B of X with the dot products times B, is it doing the same thing as the matrix?
So the question is this doing the same thing as the matrix? And the answer is yes, because you see, I computed what happens to 1, 0, and I computed what happens to 0, 1. So if you want to know what happens to, say, 7, 4, that's the same thing as saying 7 lots of 1, 0 plus all zeros of 0, 1. And so you only have to then take 7 lots of this column plus 1 lot of that column, which is exactly the matrix, plus 4 lots of that column, rather, which is exactly what the matrix multiplication does. Maybe that's worth just going over. Look, we've computed what happens if you project 1, 0. If you project that, we've seen that you get 4/5, 2/5. I'll write it vertically. So we checked that by actually computing the formula, right? That was the top half of the other board. We also checked what happens to 0, 1, and we found that it went to 2/5, 1/5. That's just what it was. Okay, so my question is, what happens to 7, say, minus 3? I'll choose that vector. Well, I want to think of that as 7 lots of 1, 0, minus 3 lots of 0, 1. And because the thing is linear, if I want to know what that goes to, it goes to 7 lots of what that goes to, which is 7 lots of 4/5, 2/5, minus 3 lots of what that goes to, which is 2/5, 1/5. It's sort of magic because, you know, since when does that happen? But because it's linear, if I want to know what happens to this, obviously it's the same as this, I can just pull out all the scalars and the additions and everything just breaks apart, and I can just say, oh, well, that one goes to that, that one goes to that, 7 minus everything is perfectly preserved. And if you think about it, this is actually equal to the matrix, without computing it, this is the matrix times the vector 7 minus 3. Because this will give you 7 lots of this column minus 3 lots of this column by the definition of the matrix product that we looked at last time. Okay, so that's why, that's a sort of a special example of why linear transformations, you only have to compute what happens to 1, 0, and 0, 1. Because every other vector you can write as a linear combination of those, and then you only have to see what happens to each of those vectors and pack it all together. It's kind of nice. It's kind of nice. Any other questions about this? Yes. Seven and minus three, well, they're not exactly acting like k's because they're not the same. They're different numbers. But, you know, when you multiply a matrix by a vector, the first coordinate of the vector picks out the first column. The second picks out the second column. And if there were a third, it would have to pick out the third column. Here there's only two. Okay? All right. So now I have to tell you a little bit about... Okay, so before I... This formula would work in three dimensions as well. This would work in three dimensions. Okay, so here's an example without 3D projection. Suppose I wanted to compute the matrix. So I'm just going to redo the previous question. Let T of X be the projection onto the vector 1, minus 1, 2 of x. Find the matrix of T. Well, of course, the formula says that this is 1 minus 1, 2 dot x1, x2, x3, if you like, over 1 minus 1, 2 dot 1 minus 1, 2 times 1 minus 1, 2. That's just the formula with V equals 1 minus 1, 2. So to find the matrix, you have to compute what happens to T, 1, 0, 0. And I'm going to plug this in. And clearly, 1, 0, 0 will just pick out the 1. So it's 1 over, the norm is 1 squared plus minus 1 squared is 2, plus that is 6. So you get 1 sixth, 1 minus 1, 2. T of 0, 1, 0. Now it's going to pick out the minus 1. If I plug in 0, 1, 0, the 1, the only thing is the negative coordinate there. And then finally, t, 0, 0, 1 will pick out the 2 over here. And so the matrix for t is, and I just pack these things vertically, and I'll multiply them out just to be clean. 1 sixth minus 1 sixth, 2 sixths is 1 third. So that's the first. This column here goes over there. And then the second column, minus 1 sixth plus a sixth, 1 third, minus 1 third. And then finally, 2 sixths is the same as 1 third. So we'll get 1 third minus 1 third, 2 thirds. And again, this matrix is symmetric. It's as if there's a mirror image there. Minus 1 sixth, minus 1 sixth. 1 third, 1 third. Minus 1 third, minus 1 third. Everything reflects around this mirror. And also the diagonals are all positive. So that's one sign that it's a projection matrix. Okay, so it works in three dimensions. Of course, it actually works in any number of dimensions as well. Projections are linear, and they're given by that formula, actually this one that I'm about to erase. Okay, any questions about the three-dimensional case?
Any matrix
not necessarily. It's not true, for example, in two dimensions, any matrix that's symmetric that has positive diagonal entries is going to be a projection, but I don't think that's true in three dimensions or higher. So it's not as easy. There is a characterization of projection matrices, but it's basically based on the fact that the square of the matrix, which we haven't defined because we haven't done matrix multiplication, but you have in class. So it turns out that this matrix squared, if that matrix is A, then A squared equals A. Remember, if you project and then project again, you get the same thing. So if you actually square this matrix, you'll get the same matrix back. And it's symmetric. So the matrices satisfying that and the ones which are, as well as symmetry, are the projections. Yeah.
Sorry, does that have to be positive along both diagonals?
No. Only the other diagonal. But really the condition is that the square, this is the condition, that the square is equal to the original and the transpose, which we haven't really done either, but it just is equal to the same, i.e. it's symmetric. Anyway, two dimensions, it is the case. Actually, wait a sec. If I want to be really precise, in two dimensions, it's not true that every symmetric matrix with positive diagonal entries is a projection. Okay, true or false? Every product, well, it's got to be more than that, because actually, if you look at this is the square root, or plus or minus the square root of this times this. It's a very special form. For example, here is a 2x2 matrix which is not a projection matrix. 1, 1, 0, 0. The identity is not a projection. It clearly isn't a projection because it doesn't project onto anything. It just keeps the vectors fixed. It is symmetric. And the diagonal entries are positive. However, it's not of this form. If you want it to be of this form, then these entries would either have to be 1 or minus 1, and they'd have to be the same. Then that would be of this form. So really, the conditions that you want are actually these two here. This is the correct thing. So I'm wrong about two dimensions. They have to be of a very special form to be projection matrices. But it is true that every projection matrix will be symmetric and have positive diagonal entries. That's not enough to say that it's projection. Another question.
You said we don't have to know the transpose.
Well, maybe we haven't learned what transpose is yet, but we will very soon. This just means it's symmetric. So you should be aware that however you want to write it, you should be aware that the projection matrices are symmetric. That's a fancy way of writing it, but you understand the concept of symmetry even if you don't know what a transpose is yet. All right. So moving on from projections, let's talk about reflections. Okay, the good news is all reflections are built up from projections. But instead of remembering any of these formulas, I would like you to try to be able to derive them based on the projection. So suppose I have a line in two dimensions. So I'm going to work in two dimensions, and I want to pretend this is a mirror, and given some vector x, I want to reflect t of x should be the reflection. Okay, so obviously if the thing is here, it will be reflected straight down. If the vector is here, it will be reflected to itself. Okay, so you can use the projection to compute what the reflection is. So what should t of x be? Well, I'm trying to say do not remember this formula. What I'm going to do is draw the projection here. So this is the projection of x, and this is some vector v. And remember, it doesn't matter whether v is unit or which way it goes. The formulas for projection, everything cancels out. So this is the projection of x onto v. Okay, so what can we say about t of x? Well, what, first of all, is this vector? This vector is x minus the projection. I'll just write it as x minus proj. So is this. So how do I get from x to t of x? Well, I kind of have to I have to subtract x minus proj twice. So in other words, I need to send x to 2 times the projection minus x itself. That will do the reflection. Okay, so let's just do a reality check to make sure that's true. What I'm saying is take an x, here's the projection. I'm saying take 2 times this projection, so that's another proj, and now subtract x. Well, I have to subtract 2x, because actually I've got to start here. So if I take x, and then times 2 times the projection, I get down there, and then subtract x. I don't mean minus 2x. I don't know what I'm talking about. Okay, let's try this again. Okay, the geometry. Here is x. There's the projection. There's another projection. Subtract x. And that gets us to the point we want. Okay. I knew something was wrong because I didn't end up at the correct position. So, all right. So the geometry tells you how to form the reflection. But it is also okay if you remember this formula. This is the reflection in V. That's all right. It may be a bad idea to, since I obviously made a hash of it, it may not be a bad idea to remember the formula directly. Now, of course, then how do you compute, for example, the reflection in the line spanned by 2, 1, in 2, 1's line? Question first? Yeah, well, I mean, x minus the projection is the perpendicular. It's the projection on the perpendicular, if you like. So a perpendicular to here, to V, it's the normal. It's the projection onto the normal. But you don't normally see it like that. You will see it, however, when we do the plane, when we do the three-dimensional version. So it does have a meaning. It's the perpendicular. The normal projection. Okay, so every vector is equal to its projection plus its normal projection. And those two things are at right angles to each other, orthogonal. Anyway, so how do I compute the reflection in 2, 1? Well, according to the formula, T of x is 2 times the projection onto 2, 1 of x minus x itself. And we already computed the projection matrix. So the matrix of T, which is not the same thing as T, the matrix of T is 2 times the projection matrix, which is 4/5, 2/5, 2/5, 1/5, as we found, minus the identity. Because if T of x just equals x, then its matrix is the identity. So another way of thinking of this first is to do a step which does the projection but replaces x by I2 of x, I2 times x, where I2 is the identity. That's the same thing. And the reason I wrote that is so you can see that you need the projection matrix minus the identity matrix. And if you work this out, this is 2 times 4/5 is 8/5, minus 1 is 3/5. 2 times 2/5 is 4/5. 2 times 2/5 is 4/5. 2 times 1/5 minus 1 is -3/5. There's the reflection matrix. Also symmetric. It's also symmetric, but it's no longer got diagonals, which are positive in particular. So it actually turns out that every two-dimensional reflection matrix. So here's a fact. 2D reflection matrices all look like this. A minus A, B, B. Where in fact, A squared plus B squared equals 1. And if you take 3/5 squared plus 4/5 squared, you do get 1. So it kind of helps to know that fact. They're all of this form, so that when you get an answer, you can do a reality check on it. Another question.
Why is there an identity matrix in the formula?
Well, I mean, if the thing was just T of x equals minus x, what would its matrix be? Rather than computing it by plugging it in, you can see that, well, T of x equals x is just the identity matrix. If you don't believe me, plug in 1, 0, and 0, 1, and you'll see. So T of x equals minus x is minus the identity matrix. And now here we have the addition of two linear functions, so that's also linear, and you just add up the matrices. So rather than computing it, it's much easier just to deal with the identity matrix. See, I mean, the point is you still have to remember that when you actually use the linear transformation, you are applying x1, x2, x1, x2 to this. This one will give you twice 2 times the projection. And this one will give you minus x1, x2.
So that's just so you can pull out x.
Yeah, I mean, if you have a linear transformation with just an x, then there's an identity matrix in there. It's like saying 1 times x, except it's a 1 matrix. The equivalent of 1 in a matrix is the identity. So it wouldn't make sense to subtract something that's not a matrix from a matrix.
Yeah,
So it's a good little trick, if you like. It's like putting in a 1 over 1 in a sense. I mean, you know, putting in 1s seems useless, but can be quite useful. Anyway, we really better move on. Just slow going. We've got to get through a bunch more stuff. So let me tell you very quickly about the three-dimensional case. The 3D case looks something like this. Okay, so you have a plane. And the plane looks like this. AX plus BY plus CZ equals some number D. Okay, so you want to reflect in this plane. Actually, I will just only consider the case where D equals 0 for simplicity. Okay, so we want to reflect in this plane. The normal, but not a unit normal, just the normal vector is ABC. So the geometry is that we have this plane like this, is the vector ABC. So call this vector V. Maybe we should call it N. What does the textbook call it? I think it calls it V. Okay, so this is a normal vector, so we have a sense of projection. So we can find the projection of x onto v. So if this is any x here, I can project it onto v. So this is the projection. Oh, there's not enough room here. Proj of x onto v. Okay, so that's just exactly what we've written before. However, what if we actually want to project onto the plane? So this is the projection as before. The same formula. But what if we want to project it onto the plane, like this? Projection onto the plane, P. Well, think of this as a projection onto the normal. The difference is going to be the projection onto P, the plane, is going to be x minus the projection onto the normal vector. Okay, let's just see why. If I take x minus the projection, this is minus the projection onto V, I get to the projection. So I go up x, but then minus its normal projection, I get a projection onto the plane. Okay, so, for example, we had computed over here, if I'm working with the vector v is equal to, what was it over there, 1? So v is equal to the 3 by 3 identity here. Okay, so this is the same sort of thing as before.
Where do you see that V is equal to?
Well, I'm just saying, suppose that V, the normal, so suppose the plane is X minus Y plus 2Z equals 0. Okay. There's the plane I'm interested in. So I take a normal vector, which is this. I already computed on that board over there the projection matrix onto that line. And I'm trying to say that the projection onto this plane is this vector minus this projection matrix, which I had worked out over there. You know, I could copy it out again, 1/6 minus, etc. And then you could actually get that as a matrix. I'm not going to do it because I don't have enough time. Okay, so any questions about the projection onto a plane? It's just the identity minus the projection onto the normal of the plane. Now, how about the reflection in the plane? How about instead, here's my vector x, here's my normal vector v, not necessarily unit, and I want to reflect down to the other side as if this was a two-dimensional mirror. Question?
Yeah, is the projection onto the plane kind of the same as the projection onto v because they're both perpendicular?
Is the projection on the plane the same? Well, it will have a very different form. It does share the property that if you project the projection, then you get the same thing back. So in that sense, it is a similar sort of matrix to the previous one. And they share some properties, but they're not the same matrix.
But I mean,
one is the identity minus the other in principle, you know, in particular.
Is that how is it though that it's the vector x minus the projection on x of x on v the same as the projection on the plane? Is that because of the angle, they share a similar angle or something?
No, it's just the geometry of the situation. Just to look at it again here, here's a normal coming out. Here's x. The projection looks like this. Okay, so if I shift the projection vector over, then it looks like this. So it's a vector whose base is now the perpendicular dropped from there. Okay, so this is x here, and this is the shifted projection. So it starts on the plane and works its way up to the same point as x, but the difference is it's perpendicular. So if you take the difference, you take x minus the projection, you have to get a vector in the plane, right? It's got nothing to do with angles or anything. It's just literally a vector addition. Okay, but now if I want to reflect it, then instead of just taking away one projection, I take away two projections, and I get down to here. I get down to the other point. So the reflection of x in P is given by x minus 2 times the projection onto the normal. And again, you could just compute it for any example by taking minus 2 times the projection matrix. Okay, so there's a bunch of different uses of projections and geometry, and you'd be well advised to understand the geometry and do some practice. So given any plane of this form, you ought to be able to compute the reflection in that plane, or the projection onto it, or the projection onto the normal. And they all use the same matrix, but just different multiples of the identity, or the projection. Okay? Question?
What's the notation for reflections?
I don't know what the notation for reflections is. Maybe it's refla of x in P, but I could have just invented that, so. Let's see. Does the textbook... Actually, you know what? The textbook says ref. So there you go. They might say ref V as well. I think it's a little bit confusing as whether they call the plane V or P. Or there's not a standard notation for it, okay? All right. There's one other two-dimensional transformation that we have to look at, and then we need to talk about inverses pretty urgently. I feel the urgent need to tell you about inverse transformations and matrices. Okay, so here goes. Before we do that, the fifth type is called a shear. Talks about horizontal shears and vertical shears. They're the easiest ones to understand. Oh, hell, I didn't even do four yet. Man, this is taking forever. Forget shears. I have to tell you about rotations, and I have to do so very quickly. Okay, so in two dimensions, if I have a vector and I consider an angle theta, what I want to do is rotate this vector by an angle theta. So I want t of x to be equal to x rotated by theta, with the normal conventions that theta is between 0 and 2 pi, and if it's bigger than 2 pi, then you actually subtract enough 2 pi's or go around many times. It doesn't make a difference. If theta is negative, of course, it goes the other way. It goes clockwise instead. So what is the matrix? Well, this is well worth knowing because it comes up all the time. In fact, all the drawings you have on your computer screen, anything, anytime you see something rotating, it's pretty much using this matrix here. Cosine theta, sine theta, minus sine theta, cosine theta. Okay, that's very, very useful. So this means that, you know, you plug in your theta and you multiply by a vector x, and it tells you exactly where the new x is. Okay, so that's a linear transformation. All right, so that's something that you should just remember, and it's fairly easy to see that the form looks like this. A B minus B, where A squared plus B squared equals 1. So it's sort of similar to a reflection matrix, which we can pan over here. We'll see. Again, you have A squared plus B squared equals minus equals 1, but here the minus is in a different position. It makes all the difference. Question?
The book has the minus sign on the other side.
Oh, does it? Okay, it's probably right then. Let's just check. If theta equals pi over 2, the matrix is 1. Let's say the book is right, which it probably is. The matrix is cosine pi over 2 is 0, sine pi over 2 is 1, and you get that. Now, what does that do to 0, 1? Well, who cares about 0, 1? What does it do to 1, 0? It sends it to 0, 1. I just plug it in and I multiply. That is what we want, isn't it? Okay, so the book is right. My notes are wrong. Yes, this time. Okay. So there it is. I apologize. I've got my thetas backwards. So this is the correct formula. In the clockwise direction, yeah. Yeah, I'm feeling a little bit backwards right now, as you could tell with this projection stuff.
So you're from down under, right?
Yes, I'm from down under. There you go. there the rotations go in the opposite direction. If you believe that, you'll believe anything. All right. Okay, so there it is. Corrected rotations. I'll have to make a little note on here. I don't know. I write these things down all the time. Write it down wrong here and just copied it. Okay, so shear. Okay, so the easiest thing to understand about a shear is if you look, say, at a horizontal shear, it looks something like this. Any vector keeps its vertical coordinate the same, but moves its horizontal coordinate by a certain amount. So k. So this is x, this is t of x. Okay? So when I say it moves it by a certain amount, what I mean is it's a multiple of k. So k times the x coordinate. So if I start down here, k looks like it's about 2. Looks like I stretched it out by 2. So the shear will take you from y to t of y. Stretches it out. By a factor of 2. So a horizontal shear has a matrix 1, x, 0, 1. No, not x. What am I talking about? K. Okay, so let's write this out. I didn't describe it very well geometrically. I'm sort of all over the place today, I'm afraid. This is x plus ky. And 0 x plus y. So actually, it's k times the y coordinate for horizontal shear. That's what I meant to say. So I take this y coordinate, and I multiply it by the k, and I add it to the x coordinate. So here, the y coordinate is negative, and the shear pushes us in a negative direction. Yeah, I mean, look, if the matrix is 1k01 and I multiply it by xy, you get x plus k times the y coordinate. So it's sort of the higher up you are, the more right you go, assuming k is positive. And the lower down you are, the more left you go. So it's just what we're doing in some sense is tilting the coordinate axes to be like that. So we're sort of... Okay, so it's a sort of perspective coordinate to the y coordinate. In general, a shear has to add. So for you to have a shear of some description, well, so it's sort of hard to talk about a general shear The idea is that you have two vectors which are perpendicular to each other. It doesn't have to be along the x direction or the y direction, but let's call them u and v. So we can have perpendicular u. And so the shear along u has exactly the same form. It sends some multiple, what sends t of u to u, while t of v should be equal to v plus k times u. So actually, that's probably a shear along v. I'm all backwards. I'm all backwards. I want to write a shear along u. It sends v to v. It sends u to... No, I'm right. Okay, never mind. Okay, so u stays where it is, but v gets added by an amount depending on how far you are. Anyway, I haven't seen too many questions about this come up. But if we do come up with shears, then next week we'll look at more of this sort of stuff. Anyway, I better really move on to 2.3. Which is in disperses. All right. Okay, so given any matrix T, we might hope to undo the effect, or matrix linear transformation. We want to undo a linear transformation. So remember, with a function, you can have an inverse function only under very special circumstances. So what is an inverse function? Well, t has an inverse if t of x equals y has one solution, has one exact solution for any y in the range of t. Okay, that's true for any function t. If T is a linear transformation, instead of range, we're now going to say image. Actually, for general functions, you often say image instead of range. But in linear algebra, it's always image. It's never range. Okay. So basically, what we want is for any vector y that you could possibly get out of the transformation, I want to be able to say, okay, I have a vector x that comes from it. Now, that's an inverse on the restricted range. So t's inverse, so that now has domain equal to the range of t, or the image of t, but not necessarily the whole space. So I'm going to be even more strict and require that the inverse is defined everywhere. So think of square root. I mean, that's an inverse of square. But you can't take a square root of a negative number. So I want to sort of get rid of that. I want to be able to take the square root of anything. I want to be able to invert anything. So from our point of view, t, in fact, so we need the range of t to be everything. Okay, so I don't really have time to go into the full details of what's going on here, as in the theory of it, but I'll give you a summary of what's going on. We start off with a linear transformation t from Rm to Rn, and we want it to be invertible. So when is t invertible? I.e., when does t of x equal y have a unique solution as in only one solution. Solution in X for every y, or for any y, in Rn. Okay, so I pick any old y, and I want to find an x, so let's take back here, y. And I want there to be only one such x. And that's true no matter what y I start with. When is that the case? So it turns out, so the answer is, you need n equals m, that's one thing, and the rank of the matrix corresponding to T to be equal to n. That's what you need. Now, in order to see this, we need to go over just a couple of things. We've already laid the groundwork for this last week. I don't want to really go over it in too much detail because I spent a little bit of time on this. But first of all, it might be useful to see why we need n equals m. Okay? So let's just sort of explore this very quickly. I've seen true-false questions that do rely on this understanding. So I'm not just showing you for the theory point. You do get tested on this. Okay. If m, why? If m is bigger than n in the matrix, so it looks something like this. It's a wider matrix. And we want to say, okay, what happens if we try to solve this equals y? Okay, remember, the solution to ax equals y looks like this. You have to solve the coefficient matrix A here with y, and the solution of this is x. Well, we know that no matter how it is, there are not enough rows, so the most number of ones is n. So there will be spare columns. In a situation like this, there are free variables. There's too many columns. There's got to be free variables. And when there are free variables, you get infinitely many solutions if it's consistent. So basically, as we saw last week, i.e., if there is a solution, has a solution, any solution, it has infinitely many. Because you can always just add the free variables and it doesn't make a difference. Okay, remember, it doesn't have to have a solution. There might be a row when you reduce it of 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. So it could have no solutions. Or it could have infinitely many, but it does not have one. So this is bad. This is no good. You cannot possibly have an inverse in that case. Okay, so n cannot possibly be bigger than n. But why couldn't it be less? Well, if m is less than n, then the situation looks like this. So it's a little bit finicky here, but imagine that you try to solve, here's A, and here's Y. So if this is the case, if we reduce this, if we reduce this to RREF, we will get some ones, 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 but we have to have at least some zero row. There's just not enough rows to go around. The most number of ones that are leading is M, and we have more rows. So we've got to have a zero row. Now, of course, we need not have a zero here. I mean, if we have a zero here, there's no problem. We could be okay. But what if we had a one there? Well, then it would be inconsistent. We'd have no solution. So all you have to do is do this, reduce it to the situation where you have a zero row, and then just pick a vector that's all zeros except, say, a one there. It doesn't even matter what these other ones are. They can be anything. But you just stick a 1 there. And then you reverse to get some y, which is inconsistent. So that's a little bit tricky and clever. But you know, we want ax equals y to always have a solution. But it doesn't, because there are some y's that will reduce to a 1 in a 0 row. It's hard to tell what they are without actually doing it. But if you do it, and then you throw in a 1 there in all zeros, and then reverse all the steps of the elimination, you can get back the original matrix and a Y, which would unwind to an inconsistent one. So in this case, then AX equals Y can be inconsistent. It doesn't have to be, but it can be inconsistent for some y, and at least one y. It is. I've given you a prescription for finding a y that's bad. So that cannot be invertible, because there's a bad y. It needs to be good for every y. Okay?
You have a row of zeros with a zero and no one at the end.
Well, if you had a zero there, then you might still get a solution. You could well get a, if all the zero rows have a zero, then you have a solution. And what I'm saying is that's not what you want. If for it not to be invertible, there has to be no solution for some value of y.
Can't you just have more equations that do make sense, that do not...
Not for every choice of y. See, the idea is if this is going to be invertible, then for any y, there's exactly one solution. Okay. What I'm trying to say is if m is less than n, then there is some y. I don't know what it is, but I guarantee you there's some y that would reduce to an inconsistent thing. And that equation will then not have a solution. Because if it did, then when you reduced it, you would have to have a zero there. Okay, you see the logic of it?
If you say so, yeah. But
if I say
why
so.
Why can't there be more equations that do make sense?
Why can't there be...
Four variables would still make sense.
Well, everything can make sense, but it has to make sense no matter what the right-hand side is. If you want it to be invertible, then for any right-hand side of those equations, you need to have one and only one solution. You need to be able to unwind it, and that's not true. Okay, so another way of looking at it is that if m is less than n, we're going from, say, a plane to a space. Say we're going from... What's going to be the effect of this? What the linear transformation is going to do at best is embed this plane as some other plane in R3. Okay, so there's no way that this plane, it could be even a line. If it's, say, a projection onto a line, the image could just be a line, or it could be the zero transformation, it could be a point. But the best we can hope for is that you'll get some plane, and there's no way that you can invert a point up here. So geometrically, it makes sense as well. But I think it also makes sense if you look at it algebraically. OK, so that's the basic idea. So m has to be equal to n. But even if m equals n, if you could reduce the situation to zeros and not have a full rank, then by the same trick, you could have an inconsistent solution. There could be a vector which is inconsistent. So this is no good. You cannot have leading zeros. They will lead to contractions, as if you were. So an idea of this would be you have a three-dimensional to a three-dimensional, but the image is just a plane. So a projection, for example, is not invertible because the rank has to be 2. The projection onto a plane is not going to flesh out the whole space. So basically, the only way we can solve anything is if we reduce to that. Then no matter what you put in there, you can invert. Okay, so that means rank n.
What was the geometric?
If we're going from R3 to R3, and we project onto a plane, okay? So that means that no matter what vector you start with, you get a vector on the plane. Okay, there's no way that could be invertible, because there are you don't get vectors that are not on the plane. So that corresponds to such a thing would have a reduced thing of 1, 1, 0. There's got to be one degree of freedom that you've missed. Okay, and that degree of freedom is that if you want to know all the vectors that project onto this, it's a whole line like this. All those vectors that pass through this point perpendicular, all projected down to the same thing. So there's a missing, there's a degree of freedom that prevents you from inverting it because you don't know which of the vectors you started with. If you just say, oh, the projection is there, what was the original vector? I don't know. Could have been this, could have been this, could have been this, this, anything that projects onto it. So that wouldn't be invertible. We can't undo the transformation. Does that make sense? Question.
Is it safe to say that all projections and all reflections are not invertible?
Is it safe to say that all projections and all reflections are not invertible? Well, who thinks that projections are not invertible? Yes, no projection is invertible. How about a reflection? Why shouldn't a reflection be invertible? You reflect from there. What happens if you re-reflect? You actually get the original vector back. So not only are reflections invertible, they are their own inverse. Okay? So actually, I was going to go through all of the types of transformations. I don't have actually enough time to do it on the board. But the only ones of the ones we looked at that are not invertible are, in fact, the projections. All of the reflections are invertible. Rotations are invertible. In fact, with the minus in the wrong place that I had, actually I had the inverse, right? A rotation by theta and a rotation by minus theta undoes that. Scaling, clearly invertible. You just replace k by 1 over k and you scale it back. And the reflections turn out to be invertible as well. And the shears are invertible. They are invertible. You just replace k by minus k and you undo it. All right, so it's very good to know, in fact. I even saw an example on a previous quiz that asked about the same thing. So it's only projections that are not invertible out of all the special transformations. All right, a question, yeah.
In the case where m is less than n.
When m is less than n.
And you have all these rows, and you have like leading ones in the first few rows.
Yeah, I mean, you don't know where the leading ones are going to be, but you know there has to be at least one row of zeros up until up until the last, up until the augmented part.
If you have like, all the bottom rows are 0 equals 0, can you delete those?
Oh, yeah, if any row is 0 equals 0, it's not a problem. But the problem is that it's not just a particular vector on the right that you care about. It's any vector on the right you have to be able to deal with. Because any vector can be undone back to some other vector here. You need to be able to solve that system no matter what y is. See, that's the idea. If A is going to be invertible, I need to be able to solve this for anything I put in there. A is fixed, but y has to be anything. And the problem is there's something that's going to go down to a 1 or some non-zero number in a zero row. For some y it'll work, but not for all y. Okay? I can always thwart you. I mean, you can't just... I mean, that's like saying, oh, well, of course, I can invert this vector in the plane. I can invert this vector. Yeah, but what about that? You can't invert that because there's nothing that projects to be that. It's not in the plane. So you can't just pick the y's that happen to have a regular zero in those places. You have to deal with all y's. Not if there's a 0, 0, 0, 1, then there's no solution.
Well, I mean, if, like, it's all 0 equals 0.
Yeah, but that's not our problem. That we don't mind if it's 0 equals 0. It's the 0 equals 1 that even one row like that is a problem. Okay? But in general, yes, if you have 0, 0, 0, 0, and you're trying to solve it, then that row is meaningless. You can ignore it. It's just here we can't, because you can't control the bit on the right of that line. You have to allow me to put a 1 there. You can't stop me. I get a choice of the y. I can do what I like there. All right. Okay. So, what do I want to say? All right. Here's the deal. Suppose t is linear and has an inverse. Okay. So then the matrix A of t has an inverse as well. So it turns out the inverse of a linear transformation is linear. I could prove that for you, but I have no time. So it turns out this is linear too. It's easy enough to prove by writing down the definitions, but you actually have to prove it. It's a theorem, if you like. If T is linear and has an inverse, then it turns out that the inverse is linear. So suppose T has a matrix A, well then T inverse has a matrix 2 because it's linear. Every linear transformation has a matrix, which we call A inverse. Okay, so what I want to do is show you how to find the inverse. So basically the idea is to use the Gauss-Jordan elimination again, except instead of augmenting by one vector, we take out A and we actually augment it by the identity matrix there. So we started off with, say, a 3x3 matrix. We put in another 3x3 matrix. And you do the elimination until you have completely eliminated the left-hand side. Well, what will you eliminate this side to? It's got to be the identity. For an n by n matrix, if you don't have the identity here, then it's not invertible. So you'd better get in, and you'll get something else here, which is actually the inverse. It's a nice little algorithm that undoes the thing. And it's described very well if you write this out as this x1, x2, x3, and this y1, y2, y3, say, and undo it all. And you'll see exactly why this gives you, I mean, think of this as ax equals the identity times y, which is just y. And then when you reduce it, you'll get the identity times x equals something times y. So it's just like solving ax equals b, except that we've done it in general as a matrix. So basically then, if you do not get in, then a is not invertible because it doesn't have rank n. It's not invertible after all. So the algorithm only gives you an inverse if you get all the way to the identity. If for some reason you get a zero row, then you don't try to argue that this has any significance here. Instead, you just forget the whole thing and say it's not invertible. So I better give you an example. So let's say we want to compute 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 3, 1, 4, 9. Does it have an inverse? If so, what is it? Well, we set up our elimination. 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 3, 1, 4, 9, augment by 1, 1, 1. Okay, so the first row is good. In fact, I just have to subtract the first row from the second row and the first row from the third row. So I get 0, so I'm going to subtract 1, 1 from 2, 3. I get 1, 2. And don't forget to do it on the right-hand side. I've got to subtract this first row from the second, so you'll get a minus 1 there. Now, acting on the third row as well, I'm going to subtract it. I'll get 3, 8, minus 1, 0, 1. Okay, now I pick this as my cursor. That's 1, so I don't even have to divide. And all I have to do is subtract this row from this row, and then subtract 3 lots of this row from this row. So let's say I subtract this row from here. I get 1, 0, minus 1, and then subtract minus 1, 1, 0, and I'll get 2, 1, 0. Leave the second row as it is, 0, 1, 2, minus 1. Okay, now subtract 3 lots of the second row from the third, and I believe you'll get 0, 0, 8 minus 6 is 2, minus 1 minus minus 3 is 2, 0 minus 3 is negative 3, and okay, so now I'm going to divide the second row by 2. One, zero, minus one, two, one, zero, zero, one, two, minus one, one, zero, 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 one, 1 minus 3 halves, 1 half. I think that's right. And now I have to add this row to the top row. So I'm going to get 3 minus 1 half, half. And I'm going to subtract 2 lots of row of the bottom row from the second row. So 1 minus 1 minus that is negative 3. 1 plus 3 is 4. And 0 minus twice a half is minus 1. Okay, let's just see if that agrees with what I had. No, it doesn't. I believe, where did I screw up? It's just this, it's this one that's wrong. That's 5. Okay, did I just not do this properly? I need to subtract.
Yeah, it should be a negative 1, not a positive 1 on the top, on the second column, or no, sorry, the sixth column, I guess.
Here, negative 1?
Negative
1. Okay, so this should be a negative 1 down here as well. Okay, I just didn't do it properly. Yes, of course, I'm subtracting. Here, I'm subtracting the second row from the first, and you need a minus 1. Sorry about that. Okay, so this is the inverse matrix. So A, if A equals this, so this is the inverse matrix. I could write that out again, but I won't. Okay, and because I had the identity, I know it's all good. If I did not get the identity here but had a zero row, there would be no inverse. A question?
Can you get different inverse matrices?
Nope, there's only one inverse matrix. You cannot get different inverse matrices.
So it's like, so you can get a different one, then you can get it incorrectly.
Yeah, pretty much. There's only one. If a matrix has an inverse, it's unique. This has to give you the right answer. If it comes down to 1, 1, 1. If it comes down to 1, 1, 0, this is meaningless. So it could be anything. Okay.
I guess the inverse of the inverse is.
Yes, it turns out that the inverse of the inverse is the original, and in fact, the way to see it would be to switch these around. If you switch these around, you will see that every step takes you exactly back along the chain. These steps are all reversible. And there's no difference between the left and the right.
Okay.
As you would know from reading Hebrew, I guess. All right.
Or driving in Australia.
Sorry? Oh, yes, driving in Australia will do that to you as well. All right. Okay, so before I move on, one more thing about inverses. It's very easy to take the inverse of a 2x2 matrix. There's a special formula that can save time. The first thing is to introduce what's called the determinant, and we'll be looking at determinants of general matrices, but if I take the determinant of A, B, C, D, this is AD minus BC. That's an important formula. Okay? So one reason we call it the determinant is given by the following formula. So A, B, C, D is invertible if and only if the determinant is not zero. So it determines whether the thing is invertible or not. That's pretty much why it's called the determinant. If it's zero, it's not. I mean, the determinant of a number makes sense as well. It's just the number itself. After all, the inverse of 3 is 1/3. This is all multiplicative stuff, because we're multiplying. So the inverse of 3 is 1/3. The inverse of minus 1/2 is minus 2. What's the inverse of 0? Doesn't have one. Okay, so in matrices, of course, it's more complicated. Having a determinant of 0 is sort of like division by 0 if you try to take an inverse. That's the analog of this. So if non-zero, then the inverse is given by, first of all, you divide by the determinant of the matrix, call this A. Then, let me make sure I get this right, I have such a bad record tonight. You switch the diagonal entries and put a minus on the non-diagonal entries. Nope, does not work for larger than 2 by 2.
But the determinant rule does apply.
Well, there is such a thing as a determinant, but it's not given by this formula. And it does tell you. Yeah, exactly like the cross product, but then we have to do it in 4 dimensions, 5. I mean, there's a whole lot of determinants. In general, they do show you whether the matrix is invertible or not, given whether it's zero or not. And they have a geometrical interpretation as volumes of parallelograms and parallelepipeds and all that. But for the moment, there's the two-dimensional thing. And it's actually really easy to see that it works. Look, just go A, B, C, D, multiplied by, ignore the determinant for the moment. In fact, put the determinant out the front as AD minus BC. It's just a scalar. And if you compute this, you'll say you get 1 over AD minus BC times AD minus BC minus AB plus AB CD minus CD minus BC plus AD. Well, this is just AD minus BC. This is AD minus BC. Cancels out, and you get 1, 0, 0, 1. So there's a little reality check that it works. Okay, so basically, you don't need to go through the full Gauss-Jordan elimination if you have a 2x2 matrix. You should really use that formula, because otherwise you're just wasting a few minutes that might be precious for thinking about a more difficult problem. So as a simple example, if I had to invert 0, 2, 1, 1, well, I just swap these entries, stick a minus in front of the non-diagonals, and divide by the determinant. 1 over 0 times 1 minus 1 times 2. This is minus 2. So this is going to work out as minus 1/2, 1/2, 0. All right. So that's what I have to say about inverses. It's a little bit quicker than what I had to say about the specific transformations, even though I had a whole page of notes. How about that? Any questions about inverses? You know how to compute them. You know when you have them. If it's not square, you don't have it. If it is square, you better hope that the rank is n. And then, yep, that's it. How do you tell if a nonlinear transformation is invertible? You take a course that is not called linear algebra, and then you can find out all about it. Because we're only considering. You had problems? Oh, yeah. Well, look, those are just sort of their little feet wet getting problems. You won't see a problem on a quiz about a nonlinear. It's just to get you to sort of see whether, you know. There's no easy way to tell whether it's invertible, but one thing you have to see is that the range is the whole thing. I think the examples in the book were just very specific things. You just have to try them out by hand. But there's no general way. The general theory, such as we have here, only works with linear transformations. Okay. Any other questions about inverses? Yes. Yes. Yep. If T has an inverse and T is linear, then its inverse is also linear. Yes.
On a quiz, are we likely to?
That could well be a true-false question. Yes. Yes, it's a fair enough true-false question. All right. I intend to move on to section 2.4, which is about matrix multiplication and is the last section covered in the quiz. Okay, so this is about matrix multiplication. But it's not just really matrix multiplication. It's actually composition of functions. Okay, please. I want you to suppose we have two linear transformations. We have a transformation R, which goes from real Rm to Rp. And we have a transformation S, which goes from Rp to Rn. So then I can form a composition. I can form T, which is S composed R, which means you do R first and then S. So in other words, T of X is equal to S of R of X. So if you like, I take X, I do R first, and then I take that answer and I do S. This is the composition. You're familiar with composition of functions. Let's just check that the dimensions work. X here starts as an M vector. Then I hit it with R and it becomes a P vector. I take that, and because it's a P vector, I'm allowed to hit it with S, because that's correct, and I get an N vector. So T, in fact, goes directly from Rm to Rn through P. It's a sort of like a chain rule type of thing, but there's no derivatives here. It's just we've gone from M through P to N. Okay? So, in fact, it turns out that if both S and R are linear, then so is T. Just like the inverse. I'm not going to prove it. It's quite simple to prove. You just look at those two rules. You try X plus Y in R, and you find, hey, R acts on X and Y independently, R of X R plus R of Y. And then you apply S, and you get S of R of X plus S of R of Y. And that's all you need. So it's worth trying it and just showing to yourself that if both of them are linear, then the composition is linear. And if the composition is linear, it must have a matrix. So suppose S has matrix B and R has matrix A. Then T will have matrix, well, it turns out that the matrix is called BA. It's the multiplication of B by A. So this is a matrix multiplication. And I just want to observe that, I mean, I put A with R because it was earlier in the alphabet, B with S. So A plus AB, RS. But you notice that the composition's actually written in reverse. So if you do R first and then S, then you write S compose R. So actually the matrix multiplication respects that convention, which is nice. Otherwise we go insane. Right? We write F of G of X. We don't write X F. That's not how it's done. So the matrix is written in the same direction. Okay, but in order to see what that is, it turns out there's a formula or a method for matrix multiplication that makes it all work. So I'm going to show you how to multiply two matrices, but I want you to understand it's not just an arbitrary formula. It is the precise formula that makes this rule work, that this is the composition matrix of doing the transformation A followed by B. So here is the deal. Suppose B, and remember, B has got to be an N by P matrix. And A, so this is B, and A is a P by M matrix. So A can multiply by an M vector and give back a P vector, which we could then multiply by this P to give us back an N. So here are the dimensions. You normally don't write them in, but I'm showing them to you. A question?
How do you know which letters go with which row and which columns?
How do you know which ones go with which? Well, I mean, whenever you say N by P matrix, it's always the number of rows by the number of columns. Okay, let me show you how to multiply these two things in practice. What you do is you take, so this is going to be some other matrix, which is going to be an N by N matrix. What I do is I take the first row of this and dot it with the first column. So this is first row of B. Dot first column of A. Okay, and that gives me just the one entry here in the upper left corner. Then, next, I have to stay with the same row but take the next column, and I do that dot. So the next thing will be the first row of B dot first, second column of A. And I keep going along the columns of A until I run out. So I start putting those entries along. Then I move to the next row of B. And I repeat the process. So this one will be the second row of B dot the first row of A, and so on. It's really, really long to write that out in words. Okay? But in algebra, it looks like this. If B has has rows that look like this, B1, B2, these are vectors, and so on, and this will have Bn rows here. And each row is a p-dimensional row vector. And I want to multiply by this matrix A whose columns, and it has m columns here. So each column is a p-dimensional column vector. And what I'm trying to say is, I take B1 dot A1, and then I take B1 dot A2, and so on, until I get to B1 dot AM. And there's M of those. And that each of those dot products makes sense, etc., because they're all P vectors, and they match. So if the number of rows, columns here, rather, is not the same as the number of rows, it doesn't make any sense. I can't compose two functions unless the intermediary step has the same dimension. Anyway, to get the second one, I'm always using B2, and so on. And then the process will end when I get Bn.A1. So I'm down to the last row of B, bn.a1, bn.a2, and so on until I've exhausted all the columns of A. So there's a lot of dot products that you have to take. It is no fun to multiply matrices. It's a job for computers to do. But for small enough matrices, we can do it by hand. So let me give you a quick example of multiplying two matrices. And then I'm going to give you a bunch of facts about matrices, and that will do it. About multiplication of matrices, that is. And they're going to have to be done a little quickly, I'm afraid. But that is it. So let's suppose I want to multiply, say, 1, 2, 3, 5, 1, minus 2. So the only matrix I could possibly multiply this is one that's 3 by something. So I'll do 1, 1, minus 1, 0, 0, 2, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so first of all, what do I expect to get? Well, this is a 2 by 3 times a 3 by 3. So I want to think of this as a transformation from R3 to R3, and then a followed by R3 to R2. So if there's any justice in the world, I should once again get a 2 by 3 matrix. Because I started with R3 and I finished with R2. So let's see what I get. So I'm saying take the dot product of this with this, which is 1 plus 2 minus 3. Now stay on the same row and take the dot product with this. 1, 2, 3, 0, 0, 2, 6. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. That's 1 times 1 plus 2 times 2 is 5 plus 3 times 3 is 14. Now move on to this row. That dot this, 5 plus 1 minus 2 times minus 1 is 2. So it's 5 plus 1 plus 2 is 8. Now, dot that row with this column. 0, 0, minus 2 times 2 is minus 4. And finally, dot this row with this column. 5 plus 1 times 2 is 7, minus 2 times 3 gets us back down to 1. Okay, and that's the multiplication. It's a pain. We have a lot of dot products to take. But that's what the formula is. That's how you get the composition. Okay, so what this means is, if you took any vector x, y, z, and you multiplied it by this matrix. You get some nasty vector with linear combinations. It's a 3x3 vector, you know, x plus z, then you get x plus 2z, and then you get minus x plus 2y plus 3z. And now you take that mess and multiply this matrix by it, and you'll get some linear combination of x, y's, and z's. You get one lot of this plus two lots of this plus three lots of this. Guess what? This, whatever you end up with, and you should just try it, multiply this by this vector, and you'll get some mess, and that will be the same as this. And I can actually tell you what it will be. If you multiply this by this vector, you should get 6y plus 14z, and then 8x minus 4y plus z. How do I know? Because it's just the coefficients of this. So the matrix multiplication just formalizes what would happen if you composed the two operations. It's kind of nice. It's just abstracted out what we have. Okay, now, here are the facts that I promised you. I'm going to give you 8 minutes of important facts. Okay. Which, of course, can all be proved. Okay, so the first fact is that AB is not equal to BA in general. In fact, this only even makes sense when the number of, see, this only makes sense if the number of rows of B is the same as the number of columns of A. Whereas this only makes sense if the number of columns of B is the same as the number of rows of A. So they have to, for this to make sense, they have to both be square matrices. Okay, so, but even if they are, that's not true. Even if A, B are square, are n by n, are both n by n, most matrices don't commute. If A, B equals B, A, we say A and B commute. So unlike normal multiplication, the order that you write it down matters. Well, that's true of functions in general. You know sine of cosine of x is not the same as cosine of sine of x. Well, matrix, I mean, even linear transformations are not commutative necessarily. Okay, so that's a first important fact. Now, the next fact concerns inverses. Okay, if A is invertible, as in A inverse exists, which means, of course, that A is square, then A times A inverse is the identity, and A inverse times A is again the identity. This is n by n, of course. Okay, so this is partly the definition of the Gauss-Jordan elimination, but really the best way to think about it is the definition of functions. If I do A, and then I do A inverse, of course, that just undoes what A did, and I get back the original vector, x, which is the same as if I just apply the identity to x. And the same the original function. So this is not a surprise. Okay, but it's useful to understand that inverse functions correspond to inverse matrices and composition corresponds to multiplication. What we've done is change exactly that. We've changed composition to multiplication by using these rules of how to multiply. And we've changed inverse functions to inverse matrices by using the Gauss-Jordan. It's really quite a nice abstraction. But ultimately, what we're doing is playing with very special types of functions. All right, here's another fact. AB times C is equal to A times BC, if this makes sense. So this is called associative. So matrices are not, matrix multiplication is not commutative. But it is associative. So the order in which you do the pair doesn't matter. And the reason is it's true for functions as well. This is true for functions. If I have three functions, f, g, and h, it doesn't matter if I do h first and then take g of that and then plug that into f, or if instead I compute f of g of something and then play a bunch of x in. It's the same thing. So that makes sense in terms of functions. But the beauty of it is that you can write a, b, c and not worry about where the brackets are. If it were not associative, as in if these two things were not the same, then it would matter. But if you write it like this, it's saying, well, you have the flexibility of computing this first and then this times that, or you can find a times b and then times c. So if you're actually computing it, it doesn't matter which order you do it. It turns out to be associative. So all of these things come straight from functions, as does this. If a and b are n by n invertible, so is the product AB or BA, as is BA, of course. So the product of two invertible matrices is invertible. And in fact, you have this nice formula. AB inverse is B inverse A inverse. This is important. And note that this is reversed. Well, of course, BA inverse, by switching A and B, you get the same formula. So there's no need to write a more general. I mean, you could call this Q and A or Q and theta or whatever, and you get this. The reason is, if you do B first and then A, and you want to unwind this, then you'd better unwind A first and then unwind B. Right? I do B. This says do B first and then A. So I do B, then I do A. Now I have to unwind A and then unwind B. So that's A inverse first, then B inverse. So that's true for any invertible functions, but it has a matrix multiplication interpretation. Quick question.
Yeah, on the quizzes, have you ever seen prove these facts?
I've not seen prove, but I've seen true or false involving these facts. And by the way, most of the facts, which are not the facts that I'm saying, turn out to be false. Not all of them, but almost all of them. They're slight variations of this. And I'll have a comment about this in the very next sentence. So I'm almost finished. I'm almost finished. I may go like 3 minutes over, but I started 3 minutes late. Okay. So here's the last fact. If you have a square matrix, say n by n, and there is an n by n matrix B with BA equals the identity,
the first matrix is A, right? Okay.
Yeah, I mean, if you have a square A and there's a B such that BA equals the identity, then you automatically know that B equals A inverse. So obviously A inverse times A is the identity. What this is saying is if there's any matrix times A is the identity, it has to be the inverse of B. In fact, B has to be invertible, and it is the inverse of A. So this goes along to what you were asking earlier. Is there only one inverse matrix? And the answer is yes, and that's it. Any matrix. This again comes from the sort of general properties of these sort of functions. So I've seen, okay, so this is true also if AB equals IN. So the beauty of this is, not only is this true, it tells you that AB equals IN as well. So you didn't know that they commute. You have just B times A is IN, but it turns out that they do commute. And if you look back over here, this says that A commutes with its inverse, because both A times the inverse and the inverse times A are the same thing. So this is saying, actually, if the product of two matrices is the identity, then they commute, because the other product, the other way, is also the identity. In fact, they're inverses. That's not obvious. That's absolutely not obvious. Here's a trick question that I've seen. It said, does there exist, is it true that if A is, say, let's say A is n by m, and B is M by N. So you can form the product AB, and you can actually form the product BA. So I was wrong before again when I said they have to be square. This actually makes sense. If you could form AB and you could form BA because N is compatible with N and M is compatible with M. So the question said, assume that A is N by M and B is M by N, where M is not equal to N, and that you have AB is the identity M. Right, B was M by N, and A, I've got it the wrong way, IN. So this is N by M, M by N, so you get an N to N. Okay, so then the question is BA equal to IN? And the answer is no. You can find a counterexample, and the solutions are online. I don't have time to go through it because there's one more thing that I need to tell you today. But what I want to say is, so this is only true if it's square. Both matrices have to be square for this fact to be true. Okay, so it's a nice fact. So then the last thing I want to show you, which I can fit on this, well, I can fit on this double board for sure, is the following type of problem. Okay, two more minutes, please. Okay, so here's a different sort of example. Say t is linear, and we know that t of 3, 1 is equal to 2, 5, and t of 1, 2 is equal to minus 1, 0. Find the matrix of t. Okay, so if we knew what t of 1, 0 was and t of 0, 1, we'd have no problem. We just write down the columns. But here we've sort of got to undo the thing a little bit. So what is this saying? Let's say the matrix of t is called A. So what do we know? We know A of 3, 1 equals 2, 5. And we know A of 1, 2 equals minus 1, 0. So here's the real kicker. What this means is that A applied to the matrix times the matrix 3, 1, 1, 2 equals 2, 5, minus 1, 0. Okay, so this seems like magic. But what I've done is I've said A times this column gives this column. And A times this column gives this column. And if you think about the way we defined matrix multiplication, that's exactly it. The rows of this dotted into the vector, but that will give you this vector here. So I'm sort of glossing over it a little bit. But if you know relations like this, it doesn't matter how many relations you have, you can actually fill in. Whenever you have a relation, you could fill in an extra column. Anyway, this...
stages, right? Just say...
Yeah, I mean, you could do it with coordinates if you want to check it. But basically, the way that I define matrix multiplication is that A of any vector will give you AV in that vector there. Okay? So maybe that's worth a few comments after I finish this example in a few seconds. This just means that A is equal to the inverse times this matrix here. And the inverse, we already know, you take the determinant, which is 6 minus 1 is 1/5. You switch these around, and you put minus signs. And then we have to multiply by this matrix. So you'll get 1/5. We'll deal with that later. And now we apply this. 2 times minus 1. This is 4 minus 5 is negative 1. This times this is negative 2. This times this is 15 minus 2 is 13. And this times this is 1. Assuming I haven't made a mistake, this comes out to be minus 1/5, 13/5, minus 2/5, 1/5. So that's how you do these sorts of problems, okay? Now, one thing in my last 20 seconds, what I've just shown you is that the matrix multiplication works like this. That's another display of having graded exponential multiplication. If I know what AV1 is, it's a vector. And this is saying if I have a whole lot of vectors, then the matrix times these columns, it's just the matrix. These are the new columns of the product matrix. Quick question over here.
On this example, if you multiply the inverse of 3112,
oh, did I get this wrong? Oh, hell. This is what happens when you do things in a hurry. Okay, guess what? Guys, I'm not going to keep you past the time. I am going... You are completely right. I multiplied it on the wrong side.